die like that on you.
My shoulder, Angel.
Don't listen to that guy. He's trying to lead you down the path of righteousness. I'm gonna lead you down the path that rocks.
I'll come off it.
You come off it.
You.
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 Oh, my God.
God? God is love. I don't love you.
Are you one of them?
Them.
Are you an angel?
I am the first angel, loved once above all others. A perfect love. But like all true love, one day it withered on the vine.
What are you?
Oh! I have so many names.
See.
Call me Dad.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist. And like that, he's gone.
When we say God is love, does that have anything to do with romantic love? Does mythology ever link romantic love and God?
Well, that's what it did do. Love was a divine visitation, and that's why it was superior to marriage. That was the troubadour idea. If God is love, well, then love is God. Okay.
There's that wonderful passage in Corinthians by Paul where he says, love beareth all things, endureth all things.
Well, that's the same business. Love knows no pain.
And yet, one of my favorite stories of mythology is out of Persia, where there's the idea that Lucifer was condemned to hell because he loved God so much.
Yeah, that's a basic Muslim idea about Iblis, that's the Muslim name for Satan, being like God's greatest lover. Why was Satan thrown into hell? Well, the standard story is that when God created the angels, he told them to bow to none but himself. Then he created man, whom he regarded as a higher form than the angels, and he asked the angels then to serve man. And Satan would not bow to man. Now, this is interpreted in the Christian tradition, as I recall from my boyhood instruction, as being the egotism of Satan. He would not bow to man. But in this view, he could not bow to man because of his love for God. He could bow only to God. And then God says, get out of my sight. Now, the worst of the pains of hell, insofar as hell has been described, is the absence of the beloved, which is God. So how does Iblis sustain the situation in hell? By the memory of the echo of God's voice when God said, go to hell. And I think that's a great sign of love, you see?
Well, it's certainly true in life that the greatest hell one can know is to be separated from the one you love.
Yeah.
That's why I've liked the Persian myth for so long. Satan is God's lover.
Yeah. And he is separated from God, and that's the real pain of Satan.
You once took the saying of Jesus, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you so that you may be sons of your Father who's in heaven, for he makes the sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the just and the unjust. You once took that to be the highest, the noblest, the boldest of the Christian teachings. Do you still feel that way?
Well, I think the main teaching of Christianity is love your enemies.
Hard to do.
I know. Well, that's it. I mean, when Peter drew his sword and cut off the servant's ear there in the Gethsemane affair, and Jesus says, put up your sword, Peter, and put the ear back on. Peter has been drawing his sword ever since. And one can speak about Petrine or Christianity in that sense. And I would say that the main doctrine of Christianity is the doctrine of agape, of a true love for him who is your enemy.
How does one love one's enemy without condoning what the enemy does? Accepting his aggression.
Well, I'll tell you how to do that. Do not pluck the mote from your enemy's eye, but pluck the beam from your own, you know?